Hello, everyone, and welcome to Arthritis Talks, Understanding Gout. I'm Dr. Sean Bevan, Chief Science Officer at Arthritis Society Canada, and thank you so much for joining us tonight. While we've come together for this event from many different places, I would like to acknowledge the land on which I am located on and which our Toronto office stands, which is the traditional territories of the Mississauga of the Credit First Nation, Anishinaabeg, Huron-Wendat, and Haudenosaunee Indigenous peoples. Today, this meeting place is home to many First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people, and I'm grateful to live on this land with my family and work on this land. Now, gout is the most common type of inflammatory arthritis, affecting as many as 1 million Canadians. And while gout symptoms may come and go, a gout attack is often sudden, painful, and debilitating. Tonight, we are so fortunate to be joined by Dr. Deslauriers, a rheumatologist with a keen interest in gout who will be answering many of the questions we receive. So before we get started, a few logistics. First, this webinar is best viewed on a laptop or desktop computer. If you have technical difficulties, please email arthritistalks@arthritis.ca for assistance. If you have a question for our presenter, you can submit it through the Q&A button at the bottom middle of the screen. We will try to get to as many questions as possible during the hour that we have together. You can click on the chat icon in the bottom middle of the screen as well to access the chat and connect with other participants and our chat moderator. Now, if you would like to close out that chat completely and find it distracting, just click the red X icon to close out of the window. We're also pleased to continue to provide captioning of our webinars to accommodate the diverse needs of our audience, and you'll see that running along the bottom of the page. So many of the questions we received in advance followed similar themes, so we will go through those first before going into the live Q&A at the end of the session. Before we get started, I want to thank our event partners, Pfizer, United Way Winnipeg, and other partners for their financial support of our Arthritis Talk series. So with that, let's get started. A warm welcome to today's expert, Dr. Jean-Philippe Deslauriers, who is joining us today from Bathurst, New Brunswick. Dr. Deslauriers and his partner welcomed twins earlier this year, so we were particularly grateful that he has taken the time to speak with us today. So if we could just first get started with the basics. Dr. Deslauriers, what is a gout attack?
Yes. So a gout attack is when we have, how can we be at risk of having a gout attack? We are at risk of having a gout attack if there is uric acid crystals inside the joints. If we do not have uric acid crystals inside the joints, we are not at risk of having gout attack. So in order to be at risk of having gout attack, we need to have uric acid crystal inside the joint. And how does those crystals inside the joint develop? They develop if and only if we have elevated uric acid level in the blood for many months to years. Okay, so when the uric acid level in the blood is elevated, and when we say elevated, it's at values above 360. When they are above 360 for months to years, they can leave the blood and go into hiding inside our joints. And once inside our joint, can lead to gout crisis, okay? What we're seeing on this graph here is one of my patients who I started seeing 1 year after I started my practice in 2019. And from 2013 to 2019, what we're seeing here is his values of uric acid, which were crazy high in the 500, 600, 700 range. He was having multiple gout crisis due to the fact that his uric acid value in his blood was very elevated and maintained elevated for many years. Okay, so that's what we're seeing here. So starting from 2013, that's on the left side of the graph, all the way to the first assessment with me, essentially 2019, his uric acid was very elevated in his blood. So when we have values above 360, that's an elevated uric acid value. When it's below 360, that's a low uric acid value. So when we have high uric acid value in the blood for many years that we can check through blood work, that can lead to uric acid crystal deposition inside the joint, okay? So if you look on the left side of the screen, what you're seeing that is needle-like shapes, what you see that is yellow and blue, those are uric acid crystals, okay? And they can deposit inside the joint, inside any joint. So what you're seeing right now, that's a knee, okay? There's it looks normal, but it is filled with uric acid crystal, and that patient is at risk of having gout attack. Having uric acid level elevated in the blood for years and years, and having uric acid crystal inside the joint initially is oftentimes asymptomatic, meaning that the patient doesn't know, okay? You can have high uric acid value in your blood for decades without you knowing it. You can be full of crystals inside all your joints without knowing it. And one day, because you had an infection, because you had a trauma, because you had a surgery, one day you have your gout crisis. And we'll see together what a gout crisis is, but it can only happen if there is uric acid crystal inside the joint, and that is secondary to elevated uric acid level in the blood for many years, okay? We're gonna see what a gout crisis is. So like we saw just the slide before, we can have uric acid crystal inside a joint, inside an articulation without us knowing it, okay? Causes no pain. When we have a gout crisis, what happens? The joint, here is the same knee, but now it is big, red, swollen. There's inflammation in it. What has changed? The crystals, the uric acid crystal that were there, that was a risk factor for having a gout attack, are now causing a problem. They are now inducing a gout crisis. And what exactly is happening? I'm gonna tell you. When we have a gout crisis, is because those crystals, the uric acid crystals that are inside the joint, they are not supposed to be there, okay? And our own little soldiers, the white blood cells or the neutrophils, their role is to go inside the joint, and if they see damage, microtrauma, for example, or if they see something that's not supposed to be there, like uric acid crystal, they will try to destroy it. And the way they try to destroy it, they try to eat the crystal. They're not strong enough to destroy the crystal, so they'll proliferate, they'll multiply. So one white blood cell that tries to attack the crystal will multiply, become 10 white blood cell, 100 white blood cell, 1,000 white blood cell, 10,000, 50,000. And when we have a lot of white blood cell inside the joint, that is called inflammation, okay? And no matter how many white blood cell we have, no matter how many times it proliferate, it multiplies, it will never be strong enough to destroy the crystal. It will simply induce inflammation, a gout crisis that will last a couple days, couple weeks. After such time, the white blood cell, they die off, but the crystals inside the joints remain, and the patient is at risk of having another gout crisis, okay? So here's a little video. What we're seeing, the needle-like shapes, those are the crystals. And the round things that you see, those are white blood cells eating the crystal, trying to destroy the crystals, but they'll never be able to destroy them. Only thing they can do is multiply, cause inflammation, big red swollen joint, excessively painful, last a couple of days, couple of weeks. After a while, the white blood cell die off, but the crystal remain. Okay, so that is a gout crisis. So once again, once the white blood cell die off, the crisis will go away. The joint will then have a normal aspect, will no longer be painful, okay, but will still be filled with uric acid crystals, okay? And then we will still be at risk of having another gout crisis down the line. So that is what is a gout crisis. Gout crisis tends to affect mostly the lower limbs, the knees, the ankle, the big toe. Not because there's more crystal there, but because we are more prone to microtrauma in the weight-bearing joint. So when we walk during the day, it can cause microtrauma. The white blood cell go in the joint to try to fix that microtrauma. They see the crystal that are not there. They try to attack it. Big red swollen, couple days, couple week, big crisis. White blood cell die off, the crystal remain. If you had a gout crisis in your big toe, in your ankle, in your knee, most likely you have gout crystal in all of your joints. And if left untreated, will lead to more frequent gout attack, more potential joint affected, longer duration of crisis, and it's going to be harder and harder to treat. So that's why it is important to recognize early on and to treat early on, because we can cure gout. If we completely remove the crystal that you have inside your joints, if we remove them, you will no longer be at risk of having gout attack, and you will be cured from that disease. Okay. And we'll see how we can achieve that together. So this is the same patient. I started to assess him in 2019. And at that time, we started to reverse the process. Okay. If our white blood cells are not strong enough to destroy the crystal, then how can we remove those crystals that are inside our joints? It's very simple. We simply have to reverse the process. If for months to years, the uric acid value was very elevated in the blood, it left the blood and went into hiding inside the joints. Okay. To reverse the process, we have to lower the uric acid in the blood. So the crystals that are inside the joint will leave the joints and go back inside the blood and then be excreted by the urine. Okay. So to reverse the process, we have to chronically have uric acid values in our blood below a certain value. Okay. Oftentimes, what we tend to try to achieve is chronically a value below 360. Okay. So I started assessing this patient in 2019, and we're able to maintain his uric acid value at a level below 360. What we need to understand, and what is very important, is that it might take as long to remove those crystals from your joint as it did to put those crystals inside your joint. So for this particular patient who had elevated uric acid level from 2013 to 2019, that's 6 years, it might take us 6 years, okay, once we have lowered his uric acid values, to completely remove his uric acid from inside his joints. So that is why it is important to recognize the disease early and institute a treatment that has the potential to get rid of that disease entirely rapidly. Because if we wait 10, 15 years to lower the uric acid value, it might take us 10, 15 years to completely remove those crystals from the joints. Okay. So for this patient that I started assessing in 2019, we started the process to reverse the process, okay, and to lower his uric acid value in his blood. And after a few years, in his case, it's going to be around 6 years, we'll be able to completely remove his crystal from his joints, okay? So initially he had uric acid crystal in his joint. His joints oftentimes were normal, but still filled with uric acid crystal. If chronically his uric acid value are maintained below a value of 360, we will remove those crystal inside the joint. Those crystal will no longer be present inside the joint. He will be left with normal joints that are not filled with uric acid crystal. He will then no longer be at risk of gout crisis and essentially be cured from that disease, okay? Oftentimes, when we have an inflammatory arthritis, like rheumatoid arthritis, for example, we cannot hope to achieve cure. What we can achieve is remission. I mean, it sleeps with treatment, but in gout, it's the only form of arthritis, among the only form of arthritis, when we can completely cure the disease, okay? But it needs to be treated adequately. It's very simple, and we'll review that together, okay?
So thank you for that very clear explanation. So how does this start? You know, why do some people develop gout in the first place?
Great, great question. I have to start to answer that question to say that there is still, even in 2023, a lot of stigma related to patients who have gout, okay? Because oftentimes people think that if you have gout, it's because you eat too much red meat or is because you are a heavy drinker. Yes, those are risk factors, but a lot of patient has very adequate lifestyle with a healthy eating habit and they're not heavy drinker and they'll still have gout, okay? And we'll see why. Like we saw previously, gouts happen when we have too much uric acid level in the blood, okay? And how can a patient have too much uric acid in the blood? We'll see that together, okay? It's essentially a disbalance between what we produce in uric acid versus what we're able to excrete, okay? So if we look at the patient we had initially, so from 2013 to 2019, the balance was favoring more production than excretion of uric acid. So his value were elevated above 360. If the balance goes more excretion of uric acid than production, then we'll have a value below 360 of uric acid. So how do we produce uric acid? It mostly comes from the diet, okay? What we eat. We'll review the big line here in this presentation, but in an hour presentation, I won't have time to cover all the eating habit that is to be prone or to be avoided in patients who have gout. The Canadian Society of Arthritis on their website have a great gout hub, great online resource for DASH diet and for diet for patients who have gout. So for more information, I strongly recommend that you visit their site. Okay, so diet rapidly, the three bad boy, if we want, it's red meat, it's seafood and alcohol, okay? There's other aliment that can be metabolized into uric acid. Essentially, it's a food that contains purine, and that purine is metabolized into uric acid, okay? So through the diet, the normal muscle mass, okay? The bigger we have a muscle mass, the normal degradation of the muscle will produce uric acid, okay? That's why, one of the reasons why male are more prone to male men are more prone to have gout attacks than female women, because typically men have a bigger muscle mass. That's why they're more prone to have gout. But we can have gout in women as well. It's just less often, okay? And the big important part, it's genetic, okay? Because we can have two patient, identical weight, identical muscle mass with identical eating habit. And one patient will produce more uric acid than the other because their genetics makes it more easy to metabolize the purine or the muscles into uric acid, okay? And how do we excrete? How do we remove the uric acid from the blood? Well, it's from your kidney. It's excreted in the kidney. So if, for example, we have a patient with chronic kidney disease and he cannot easily filter the uric acid, he'll be more prone to have high level of uric acid and then gout. And some medication, most often it's medication that we give for blood pressure, so to treat high blood pressure, their side effect oftentimes is to inhibit the kidney from excreting the uric acid. Okay, so if we have thiazidic, for example, hydrochlorothiazide, or if we have diuretic, that those medication can prevent the kidneys from adequately filtering the uric acid. And once again, it's genetic as well. So some patient can have the same kidney function, and one will still filter better the uric acid than the other due to their genetics. Okay, so that's if we have an imbalance where there's too much production and not enough excretion, like my patient had, well, for years and years, then you'll have too much uric acid in your blood. Will leave the blood go into hiding inside your joints, and that will make you at risk of having gout attack. And what is a gout attack? It's when your own white blood cell go inside the joint, they see those crystals that are not supposed to be there, attack it, big red swollen, an attack, and then the attack subside, but the crystals remain. So I'm gonna go with the next slide. So this is my microscope that I have here in my office, and when I do joint aspiration, when I remove fluid from a joint of my patient, I can put it on a microscope slide and I can look directly in the microscope to see if there's crystals inside the joint. And I'm a bit high tech, so I can show that to my patient on my big TV that you see behind me. So we're going to see what they look like. Okay. I'm going to see what the crystal looks like. That's my microscope. It's connected to a camera, and then it's going to be shown on the big TV. So that's when I show my patient who have gout. So all the blue needle-like shape and all the yellow needle-like shape, those are all crystal. And it is the form of arthritis that causes the most pain. Just imagine you have crystal-like forms in your joints and your white blood cell are trying to attack them. It causes tremendous pain. Okay. Tremendous pain. Usually what patients describe is just putting the bed sheet on my big toe or my knee causes atrocious pain. Okay. It's because essentially you have needles inside your joints. Okay.
Thank you so much, Dr. Deslauriers. I know this is an important question because we've had so many on this topic. So could you give us a sense of what are the treatment options that are available to treat gout?
Most definitely. This is a presentation that I give to my medical student, to the nurse practitioner that comes in rotation, to my resident in family medicine, resident in internal medicine, resident in rheumatology. And one important aspect that I try to make them understand is that, yes, it is important to treat the acute crisis, but if you do not treat the underlying cause, which is too much uric acid in the blood, you're not doing a very good job, okay? Because you're treating the acute crisis, but it will always come back. It will always come back, and it will only come back more severe, more intense, and harder and harder to treat, okay? So there is three steps to treat gout. Okay, and it's important that those three steps be followed. Okay, and we're going to review them together. It's treating gout is very simple, very simple. Okay, what is the first step? Well, the first step is to treat the acute attack. Okay, the natural evolution of a gout attack is that it will go away by itself, okay? After a while, those white blood cells that are inside the joint and that are trying to kill those crystals, after a while, they will die off. After a couple days or a couple weeks, they will die off. The crystal will remain, but the crisis will be over, okay? Why do we treat an acute attack is because we want the symptoms, the pain, the swelling to be less severe, to cause less pain and to last not as long. Okay. So we can give medication to treat the acute attack. Okay. Once we have an acute attack of gout, we have to determine whether or not there's an indication to lower the uric acid value. So essentially to determine if there's an indication to recommend to lower the uric acid. That's the second step. The third step is a bit more complicated to understand, but I'll try to put it as simple as possible. When we have too much uric acid in the blood, okay, and we decide to give medication to lower the uric acid in the blood, during that phase, okay, when we initially lower the uric acid within the first few months, we will be more prone to have gout attack, okay, until we have achieved our target of uric acid. And why would we be more prone to have gout attack during that phase? To try to understand it is, you have a lot of crystal inside your joints, okay? We're giving you medication to lower the uric acid value in your blood, okay? It will go down in your blood. And we are starting to remove those crystals that are from your joint, and we're bringing it back to the blood and then excreted to the kidney. But when we start to remove those crystals from your joint, the white blood cell, the little soldier, they will recognize that. They'll see something's moving. This is not supposed to be there. And I'll try to attack them and then cause a crisis. So within the first few months that we start, for example, allopurinol, we will be more prone to have gout attacks induced by the allopurinol in the first few months when we initially lower the uric acid value. Okay, so when we first lower the uric acid value, we tend to give another medication like colchicine or NSAID, like Celebrex, for example, or naproxen, just to appease those crises that will be more prone to happen in the first few months, okay? But we'll see all those together. So how do we treat an acute attack? This is what we can use, okay? So an acute attack, a swollen joint, big, red, and swollen. We can use colchicine, we can use NSAID, either by mouth or topical through creams. We can use a localized cortisone shot. We can use prednisone by mouth. The body itself can produce cortisone. We can give ACTH, that's gonna help our surrenal gland to produce more prednisone. I've never personally used it, but it's described in the literature. And then finally, for very, very resistant cases of acute crisis that affect many joints at once in a patient that's hospitalized and we've tried everything and nothing works, then we can sometimes try IL-1 inhibitors, but that's off-label, exotic type of treatment and usually only done by experienced rheumatologists, okay? So that's the available treatment option in terms of medication for an acute attack, okay? That's medication. What can you do beside medication, okay? Stay hydrated, put ice on the joint. Stay calm, don't go run a marathon if you have a big red and swollen knee, okay? Those sort of things. And of course, consult, and consult rapidly, because it's always easier to treat an attack when it just started, then when it's been 5 or 6 days that it's on, it's only getting progressively worse. Why? Because the neutrophil, usually there's only one white blood cell or neutrophil inside the joint, but every day that goes by, it multiply, more and more inflammation, and then it's harder to treat, harder to remove that inflammation, okay? We're gonna see those medication one by one. We're gonna go relatively rapidly, but those are the medications that can be used in an acute crisis setting. So the colchicine, how does it work if we use it to treat an acute attack? Well, that medication specifically works by limiting the ability of your white blood cell to multiply. Okay, that's why it works best when given in the first 48 hours, okay? Because the white blood cell didn't have enough time to multiply to very high numbers, okay? So if you have a gout attack and it's been going on for 4 days and a physician decides to give you colchicine to treat it, it's not very likely to succeed because the white blood cell already had time to multiply, okay? So colchicine, yes, can be used, but very early when it just started. Okay. What is more commonly used and what works better, honestly, is NSAID. Okay. So celecoxib, naproxen, indomethacin. Okay. Those are oral, non-steroid, anti-inflammatory that we can use to treat acute attack. Okay. We tend to give those medication until at least 3 days that the crisis is resolved. Why do we say that? Is because if you wake up in the morning and you feel fine, but last night you had a big crisis, it might not be completely gone. And then we don't want to do yo-yo. You don't want to have an acute crisis and then almost gone, and then you stop your medication and it comes back. And so you wait 3 days for it to go down completely. You're sure it's all gone, and then you can stop your medication for the acute crisis. Okay. We can use cream, NSAID cream, but it's not very efficient. It's more like an add-on treatment that we can use. Okay. So if someone gives you colchicine, you might put some NSAID cream on top of it, or oral NSAID and NSAID cream on top of it. Sometimes we use that as an adjunct therapy. We can use localized cortisone shots. So let's say I have a patient who has the big toe that's swollen, and I have contraindication to oral medication. I might just say, okay, well, we're going to disinfect the joint, and then I'm going to inject cortisone directly inside the joint. Okay. Oftentimes, what I like to do as well is to remove the fluid, just to look in the microscope to make sure that it is a gout crisis and not something else, like an infectious arthritis, like a septic arthritis. Okay. But we can do a localized cortisone shot. It works very well. And if we tried all that and doesn't work, we can add oral prednisone to try to calm the acute crisis. Like we said previously, in very, very refractory cases, in all my practice, I've seen over now 9,000 patients. I have 3,200 active patients under my care. I have hundreds and hundreds patients that I follow in my chronic gout clinic. I've had to use this medication, IL-1 inhibitor, twice in 5 years of practice. Okay, so it is described, it is excessively expensive medication, but for very, very, very refractory case, it can work. Know that it's available for a very refractory case of acute gout attacks that affect many joints, that lead the patient to be hospitalized. We can use that. It needs to be done with an experienced rheumatologist. Okay. Now, we did treat the gout attack, but now we have to determine whether or not there's an indication to lower the uric acid that we have in our blood. Because essentially, that's why we have the gout attack. We have the gout attacks because there's uric acid or gout crystal inside the joint. And those are caused by the fact that we have too much uric acid in the blood. So if we don't treat that, then it might just happen again and again and again. So what are the indicate, we'll see what the classic indication to lower the uric acid are. If there is an indication, we'll review how can we manage to lower that uric acid through lifestyle. Sometimes, like we saw previously, the increased uric acid is caused by another medication that's used for something else. Oftentimes it's certain medication for high blood pressure that we'll review together. And finally, we can give specific medication that's going to help your kidneys to better filtrate the uric acid. Okay. And when we use all that in combination, lifestyle, modify the patient high blood pressure medication, for example, and give specific medication like allopurinol to help the kidney better filtrate the uric acid from the blood, well, we have to try to achieve a target, okay? If I give a patient allopurinol at 100 milligram, and then I close my eyes, and his uric acid value remain at 500 or 600, I'm not doing any good. It's still too high, and it will still accumulate more and more inside his joint, okay? So I cannot just give medication or give lifestyle advice and just close my eyes. I have to follow the uric acid value, usually. If we want to be efficient, we can check them every 4 weeks and readjust the treatment accordingly to make sure that we're on the right track and to make sure that we are achieving the target, okay? Essentially, a low value of uric acid. So what are the indications to lower the uric acid? There's many different guidelines with many different criteria. The most often criteria used is the following, okay? So if we have one gout attack, okay, and we have chronic kidney disease, then there's an indication to treat. There's always an indication to treat the acute attack, but there's also an indication to lower the uric acid value in the blood. Okay, so if you had an attack and your kidneys are not working well, then you will be much more prone to further attacks. That's why we want to lower the uric acid value in your blood. If you had two attacks or more within the last 12 months, or if you had one attack that affected more than one joint at once, you will be more prone to have subsequent attack. Therefore, you have an indication to lower your uric acid value in your blood. Most kidney stones, about 80% of kidney stones, are due to too much uric acid in the blood. So if you had a gout attack and a history of kidney stone, that's also an indication to lower uric acid. And if you have tophi, what is a tophus or tophi? Multiple is tophi, one is tophus. Well, it's when the crystals are not only in the blood and in the joints, but are now in your soft tissue as well, okay? We see that in very severe form. We see that when the uric acid value was elevated for 8 years, 10 years, higher than that, and then it can deposit, it becomes white-colored nodule, usually in the ear, behind the ear, or in the extensor of the hand, the elbow, the knees, and on the Achilles tendon. Okay, that's usually where we see them. And those tophus can lead to bone erosion. Okay, so oftentimes we do x-ray and we can look for specific bone erosion that we can see with gout. Okay, so if we have any of those, we have an indication to lower the uric acid value in order to cure our patient. The majority of the time, there's an indication to treat, to lower the uric acid. Okay, so how do we do that? Lifestyle habit, try to avoid red meat, alcohol, seafood, try to stay healthy, have an adequate weight, stay hydrated. That's the main thing. For more detail, Society of Arthritis of Canada online have great resources, okay? Medication that can bring the uric acid value higher, okay, that can be used for high blood pressure, for example, tiazidic, diuretic. What medication that can be used for other entities than gout that can also lower the uric acid? Losartan or calcium channel blocker. Those are medications that we can give for high blood pressure, but their side effect is to help your kidney better filtrate the uric acid. So if I have a patient that has gout, okay, that is on a diuretic, I might recommend that we're going to change your hydrochlorothiazide, for example, for your high blood pressure, to losartan. And just doing that change sometimes is enough to achieve the target that we aim for. Those are the medications that are classically used to specifically help your kidney better filtrate the uric acid. The most commonly used medication is allopurinol, okay? That's the medication we usually use. And once we start the allopurinol, okay, the dose for which we start is depending on the kidney function. If you have a normal kidney function, you can start at a higher dose. If your kidneys are damaged, or if you have chronic kidney disease, we usually start at a lower dose, but we can titrate up slowly in order to achieve the value of uric acid that we want, okay? And it's the same principle for febuxostat, okay, which is the second line of treatment. It's not better than allopurinol, it's just for those who don't tolerate allopurinol, there's other lines of treatment, okay? Once again, we have to achieve a target. If there is no tophus, okay, or no erosion, we want below 360. If there is tophus or erosion, those are more severe form, we want to be a bit more aggressive, and instead of aiming at values below 360, we aim for values not above, below 360, that's what we aim for. If they're more aggressive, tophus or erosion, we aim for value below 300, okay? So we do that, and that's for the allopurinol, that's how we titrate the dose in order to achieve the value that we want. Same principle for febuxostat. Okay, This is the fourth step in the treatment of gout. Okay, this is a graph that I've created with the designer in Sherbrooke. If you look on the bottom left corner, on the y-axis, you have the uric acid value. On the x-axis, you have the time. First phase, it's when the uric acid value is very elevated in the blood. Okay, it will leave the blood and go into hiding inside the joint. Second phase is when we start to lower the uric acid. So we give allopurinol to help the kidney better filtrate the uric acid inside the blood. That will lower the concentration of uric acid inside the blood. During that second phase, that usually lasts 4 to 6 months, during that second phase, we'll be more prone to have gout attacks, okay? During that second phase. And during the third phase is when we have achieved the target of uric acid that we want. During that third phase, we are continuing to remove those crystals. And the fourth phase is when there's no longer any crystals inside your joint, then the uric acid will drastically diminish, okay? Why? Because whatever we're filtering from the blood cannot be replaced by what's inside the joint. So once we have achieved that fourth phase, we can lower the allopurinol dose and oftentimes stop it entirely, okay? But it need to be followed. So that's how the fourth step of treating the fourth phase. It's very simple, very simple. And what we see on the video on the left corner is the white blood cell trying to attack the crystal, and gout can affect any joint. This is one of my patients on his hand. That's tophus on his hand, the big white, whitish yellow lumps that you see in his digit. Those are tophus, excessively painful. This patient has been left for 30 years and plus with very high uric acid value before he was under my care. It's sad, but we see it. If we move forward, that's another of my patients. That was, his whole body was covered with deposition of tophus, a lot of crystal, not only inside his joint, but also in his soft tissue, okay? So what we're seeing is, I started assessing the patient in 2019, but for years and years, he had values in the 500-600 range. That's in from his blood. So it went to hiding inside his joint and it's inside his soft tissue. I started assessing him here. During that phase, okay, when we lowered his uric acid value, he didn't like me very much because he was more prone to have more gout crisis, okay? But after we have achieved the value, we were able to remove his crystal from his joint, and look at this. This lump here is no longer there. This lump is a lot less than it was. Here, the second toe is back to normal. This third toe is back to normal. The big, big lump that we saw in the big toe, it's still there, but a lot less. And that was in 2019. I've seen him recently and there's none left, okay? This gentleman loved to work with his tractor. He has a John Deere. I'm more of a Kubota guy, but it's okay. We still love each other. But now he's able to play with his tractor again, okay? We were able to achieve cure with this patient with adequate treatment and, more importantly, adequate follow-up, okay? Because we have to give medication, but not just close our eye. We have to follow the uric acid, make sure it is maintained below the value that we want, okay? That's another patient. Like I said, this is the patient we saw initially. He had tophus in his elbow, but as well as in his hand. And unfortunately, those tophus created erosion in his hand, and the patient is now left with chronic hand deformities due to his disease that was left untreated for years and years. Okay, so it's important to recognize early, to treat early, because we want to prevent irreversible damage. This is an extreme cases, okay, but I'm still seeing this, and I shouldn't, because it's easily treatable. Okay, so once again, like we said, when we first start to lower the uric acid value in the first couple of months, we'll be more prone to have gout crisis. So during that first few months that we lower the uric acid value, we chronically, crisis or not, give medication, okay, to lower the inflammation, because we will be more prone to gout crisis. So if they happen, we want them to be little crisis and not big crisis. So that's why we either keep colchicine or keep NSAID, or keep a low dose of prednisone until we have achieved our the target value, and then we can remove those medication and keep the allopurinol and then maintain that lower value of uric acid in the blood for years. And then we'll be able to completely remove the uric acid inside the joint and the patient will be completely cured. No more gout crisis. Okay. Yeah. So it's very simple, very simple. Okay. So colchicine, when give it in that circumstance, we have to adjust it with the kidney function, NSAID orally. Same thing. We have to use it if the colchicine isn't enough. If the colchicine and the NSAID isn't enough, as last resort, we can use prednisone during that second phase when we just started to lower the uric acid value in our blood. Okay, so I'm at the 45 minutes mark, right on the dot.
You are. Thank you so much. And I think just in the interest of time, I'm going to just jump ahead to many of the questions that we received this evening. And you've done a great job of actually answering so many of them as we go. But let me start with this one. Could you explain a little bit about what pseudogout is and how that compares to what you've just been talking about?
Yes. So why is it called pseudogout? It's because the clinical manifestation of an acute crisis is very similar. Okay. So when we say we have gout crystal, it's uric acid crystal. Okay. But when we have pseudogout, it's not crystal from uric acid. They are crystal from pyrophosphate of calcium. Okay, so there is no uric acid in those types of crystal. Okay, gout with uric acid crystal, there's a relation to what we eat. Okay, pseudogout, there's no relation to what we eat. Okay, pyrophosphate de calcium. And even if we eat a lot of calcium, it will not generate more pyrophosphate of calcium crystals. Okay, there is oftentimes two big risk factor to have pyrophosphate of calcium inside a joint, and it's female sex and advanced age. Those are the two big factor. And if I close my eyes, okay, and I do an x-ray of the knee of 100 patients in Canada that are above 65 years old, 15% of those patients will have those crystal inside their joint on x-ray. Okay, that we can see it on x-ray because it's calcium. Okay, the x-ray, we see calcium 15%, but it's a lot less that will cause pseudogout crisis. Okay, and what is a pseudogout crisis? Same principle. The white blood cell goes inside the joint, they see the crystal that are not supposed to be there, try to attack them, big red swollen, they're not strong enough to destroy the crystal, the pseudogout crystal remain. We are more at risk of having other crises down the line. The big difference between gout crystal and pseudogout crystal, we cannot remove them. Okay. Once they are there for life. But gout crystal that are caused by uric acid value, we can remove them very easily, like we just saw. And once they are removed from the joint, it's over. The gout is cured and you will no longer be at risk of having gout crisis.
Okay, that's great. You've talked a lot about the importance of monitoring the uric acid levels in the blood. Would you recommend people get that checked regularly as sort of a prevention strategy for gout, or what would you say that?
No. So you can have hyperuricemia. That's the medical term for high uric acid value in the blood. That can happen, but will never cause problem. Okay. When it's chronically elevated, but we never experience a gout crisis, oftentimes we don't give medication to lower the uric acid because we always have to do the balance risk benefit. But if we have a gout crisis, most definitely we have to determine whether or not there's an indication to lower the uric acid value. Yeah.
Okay.
But usually no, we don't treat asymptomatic hyperuricemia unless there's a history of previous gout crisis, but we have to have a previous gout crisis. Yeah.
Okay. What about, you talked about many medications to treat gout, and people have asked, how long would people expect to stay on those medications, especially allopurinol, which many people obviously are taking?
Yeah, so if, for example, I see a patient and it's his first gout attack, okay, and he had chronic uric acid level for the past 2 years, and I give the allopurinol, and I don't just give it and close my eyes, okay? I give the allopurinol, and then I monitor it to make sure that the dose that I give is strong enough to lower the uric acid at the value that I want. Usually after 2 years, we're gonna be able to wean it off and then stop it entirely. However, what I commonly see, okay, is patients have had 20 gout attacks before someone realized maybe we should lower his uric acid value, and their value were elevated for 10 years. Then even if we achieve the target with an adequate dose of allopurinol, it might take us 10, 15 years to achieve the target. The other thing that I commonly see, okay, is physician saying, you have gout, you need allopurinol. And then they give 100 milligram, and then they close their eyes and they don't monitor the uric acid value. And then the patient remains at uric acid value in the 400 or 500 range. Well, he can take that allopurinol at 100 milligram for 60 years. It still won't be enough because we have not achieved the target that we hope for uric acid. If you're under my care, 80% of my patient will achieve the uric acid value within 6 months. Okay. Why can we achieve it relatively so rapidly? Because I monitor it every 3-4 weeks. Okay. So when we start the allopurinol at a certain dose, we'll see the full effect of that dose after 3-4 weeks. Okay. So there's no point of giving the medication and just recontrolling in 6 months' time. Because if you do that, it's going to take so much time to achieve the target. And during all that time where you haven't achieved the target, well, the crystals keep accumulating inside your joint and your crisis will become more and more frequent, more and more painful. That's not good.
Okay. So that actually picks up a little bit on this question. What kind of specialists should people be seeing to manage their gout? A family doctor, rheumatologist? What kind of physicians should people be seeing?
I want to say family physician. Okay. I want to say family physician. But what we also have to recognize, and this is a honest truth, is that in the formation of many primary care physician, family physician, nurse practitioner, a rotation in rheumatology is not obligatory. So I have many of my colleagues that are great physician, great physician, great nurse practitioner, but never did one day in a rheumatologist's office, okay? So it can be the first line, and it should be the first line, and I'm working hard on it by giving courses, by accepting resident, by doing online course like this one. But if I prescribe the allopurinol and I follow it, or if a family physician prescribed the allopurinol and follow it, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. And if the patient is aware, so those who are attending this conference are aware that, hey, my family physician or my nurse practitioner has prescribed allopurinol, but hey, we need to check it. We need to achieve the target value because honestly, access to first line is excessively difficult in Canada. Access to rheumatologists is even more difficult. So if I give that everybody that has gout, which is the most frequent inflammatory arthropathy in Canada, if I say everyone should be under rheumatologist care, it's never going to happen. It's never going to happen. Yeah.
Well, you're doing a fabulous job. So we certainly thank you for that.
Thank you. So family physician, nurse practitioner, could easily, if they know what they're doing. Nutritionists can help as well to make sure that we have a balanced diet and yourself, meaning you have to recognize your symptom, you need to consult, you need to make sure that the medication that you're receiving is the right medication, that the values are being followed of uric acid, that you follow a right diet. And once again, for that, the internet site, Society of Arthritis of Canada, very good, very good.
In your patients or at large, is there a relationship between joints where you're seeing gout and other forms of arthritis, osteoarthritis in particular, or actually any other disease for that matter? What are the relationships that people need to be aware of?
Yes. So if So like we saw, we could be more prone to have gout attack if we are obese and then have higher muscular mass, okay? So if you the more weight you have on your weight-bearing joint, the more prone you will be from having osteoarthrosis, which is wear and tear. Okay, so there's this association. The other thing is, we can having one form of arthritis doesn't prevent us from having another form of arthritis. Okay, so if I have a patient who has rheumatoid arthritis and gout, well, when this patient has an attack from his rheumatoid arthritis, which is a lot of white blood cell swelling, if those white blood cells see that there's crystal inside the joint, well, my patient will be also at risk of having a gout crisis. So it's important to recognize that a patient can have two diseases at the same time. Yes, it's not a protecting factor. We can have two type of inflammatory arthritis at the same time, or we can have non-inflammatory arthritis like osteoarthritis, as well as an inflammatory arthritis like gout, which is the most common form in Canada, which is the easiest form to treat and among the only form where we can achieve complete cure.
Could you spend just a moment explaining what are the earliest symptoms of gout that people might experience?
Yes, asymptomatic. No symptom at all. That's the early phase. The early phase is when her uric acid level are very high in the blood, and then it goes inside her joint and into hiding. Okay, that's the and the classic. It's elevated in the blood for years. We have one crisis. It goes away, and then we think, it was just a couple of days, not too bad. And then it happens again in 8 months time. Oh, this time it was a bit more painful, and it lasted a lot longer. And then next time it's in 4 months, and now it's affecting two joints, and maybe I should consult then, or maybe you did consult, but there was no treatment to the underlying cause, which is too much uric acid. So that's the classic evolution of a patient.
Okay. Could you explain a little bit about why gout can get worse after certain activities that people do?
Yeah. Whatever can increase the likelihood of a white blood cell to go into contact with a crystal inside the joint. Okay. So if we are dehydrated, for example, okay, we'll be more prone that the white blood cell go inside the joint, see those crystal, the gout attack. If we do exercise and we induce microtrauma, the white blood cell would go inside the joint to try to see where the microtrauma is, try to repair it. But while doing that, we'll see the crystal, try to attack it, and then cause the big crisis. Yeah. So essentially, that's why. So risk factor, once we have uric acid crystal inside the joint, dehydration, fever, strenuous exercise, also rapid fluctuation of uric acid in the blood. I took 5 beers, I ate 3 lobster, I ate 3 burgers. I'm a bit hungry because I didn't eat supper, but you get the drift, okay? Yeah.
That's great. Well, thank you so much for sharing your expertise with us tonight. We will send you the comments that came up in the chat and the questions. We just love your positivity and all the optimism that you're giving patients who are living with this disease. So thank you so, so much. We would like just to take a few moments to get the audience's feedback on today's presentation. So for those of you who are watching on the Zoom, you'll see a poll question come up on your screen with some answer options. So do click on the response that reflects your thoughts. I feel more knowledgeable and empowered after attending this webinar. We will also be sending you an evaluation form when we email the recording and the slides. So if you aren't able to access the poll question, you'll have the opportunity to give us feedback at that time. We really do use these survey results to shape for future Arthritis Talks webinars, and we truly value your input. So thank you so much in advance. Once again, we are grateful to Pfizer, United Way Winnipeg, and others for their financial support of this event. Initiatives such as this webinar are supported by our valued sponsors and donors, including those who have generously left a gift in their will to Arthritis Society Canada. May is nationally recognized as Leave a Legacy Month, and we encourage you to learn more about how to plan your gift in your will to help continue essential programming long in the future. Visit arthritis.ca/plangiving to learn more. And before we wrap up tonight's session, I want to encourage you to visit arthritis.ca/people's choice. This is very exciting. Vote for your favorite arthritis innovation as part of our Arthritis Ideator Awards. Your vote will help decide the winner of $50,000 to advance their practical solution that could transform the lives of people living with arthritis. Voting ends tonight at midnight. So with that, this concludes Arthritis Talks, Understanding Gout. On behalf of all of us, thank you so much for joining us today. Please stay well.